U.S. Attorney Kurt Alme with us right here in studio. Kurt, always a pleasure to have you on the show. Thanks for coming back in here.
Good morning, Aaron. It's good to see you, but even better to come up here and see the view.
Isn't it a great view? You got the Beartooth Mountains behind you. We got folks listening in the Flathead with a beautiful view there, too, of their own. So, yeah, top floor of the Doubletree Hotel here at downtown Billings. So not too far of a walk for you from the U.S. Attorney's Office. But, you know, earlier this week, I wanted to start... Yeah, I got into this little back and forth with some folks on Twitter talking about meth and crimes and prosecutions and all this stuff. And long story short, there's some folks out there who think, okay, look, law enforcement isn't going to get this problem done. It's this meth problem, it's just too complex. We can't oversimplify it by saying that we just need more law enforcement and we need more prosecutions. And my reaction was like, nobody's saying that. But what we are saying is you have to have prosecution, you have to have law enforcement. And it seems like we're now finally starting to get that again here. I don't know your thoughts.
Oh, the meth problem is big enough that we need to hit it on all fronts. You know, we take a look at the efforts we've done so far on enforcement, prevention, and treatment in the last decade. We thought we'd done a pretty good job of reducing meth use and bottomed out in 2010. But this is a supply-driven problem. About 2013, 2014, meth in large quantities, high purity, low cost, started to flood into our state that was coming in from Mexican cartels. And it caught the state, I think it's fair to say, it caught us flat-footed. And now we're all working on all fronts to see what we can do to reduce supply, reduce demand, try to get back on top of this problem.
There was a press release that I shared with some of our listeners from the Yellowstone Substance Abuse Connect Coalition that had just some shocking numbers here. Well, I should say they should be shocking, but we've already known that we saw a 400% increase in meth violations from 2010 to 2014. So it's not, but still, these still stand out. Statewide violent crime was up 35% from 2013 through 2017. And they attribute this largely to the meth epidemic. Violent crime in Billings alone up 75% from 2010 to 2017, which led to an increase in child abuse and neglect cases, an increase of 177% from 2014 to 2018. 65% of those cases, at least one primary caregiver is abusing methamphetamine. So I think it's very clear that we had a problem with that. We've had a problem with meth. We continue to have that problem. But these new numbers that you shared this week, I think, give us some hope out there.
They do. You know, you quoted some key numbers there, Aaron. You know, 35% increase in violent crime in Montana from 2013 to 2017 puts Montana as the second highest violent crime rate in the Northwest, a distinction we certainly don't want to have. And what we've been doing this last year is law enforcement has done a tremendous job. We have got, Aaron, some really dedicated officers, deputies, agents, troopers, prosecutors, as you know, in this community and across the state who worked really hard this last year. We were able to reduce that trend. So let's see, we started in April of last year. The 12 months prior to beginning, we had a 26% increase in murder, robbery, and aggravated assault in Yellowstone County. The 12 months before that, we had almost a 16% increase. In the 12 months since PSN began, we've almost stopped that increase. We only had a 1.3% increase last year. Now, we'd like to do better. We'd like to decrease violent crime, and law enforcement is going to continue to target meth traffickers and armed robbers and these violent felons with firearms. I think you may have saw yesterday, 212 firearms were taken off the street, including 57 semi-automatic rifles from either prohibited felons or from drug traffickers.
All right, we've got U.S. Attorney Kurt Alme with us here in studio. This is the man who was appointed to be the lead prosecutor. This was President Trump's appointee as U.S. Attorney for the state of Montana. And, you know, Kurt, a lot of us here in Montana, luckily, we know, you know, sometimes these are political appointments and you know, they'll put political connected folks in these jobs. But folks know you going back several years. You hit the ground running as U.S. Attorney for Montana because you've already worked as, I think you were the first assistant U.S. Attorney prior. But you've also seen this angle from the community support angle too, by working with the Yellowstone Boys and Girls Ranch Foundation and all of that too. So, but I know for those of you who know you, who've seen you around town, you had a plan, you had a focus on going after this drug problem even before you were even nominated, even before you were even put in the job as U.S. Attorney. So it's no surprise to the rest of us that you've hit the ground running here.
Well, that's right, Aaron. I was at Yellowstone Boys and Girls Ranch Foundation, and of course the ranch works with mentally ill children, but also children with substance abuse problems. And so when I was there about 2013, 2014, we really started to see meth back into the state, and it hit the foster care program. It hit kids, hit the jails, it hit the hospitals, it hit substance abuse facilities. It's hit our health care, it's hit mental health care. Graduation rates in Billings have been affected, and across the state. This isn't just a Billings issue, and it isn't just a law enforcement issue. So I was grateful, as you said, that Senator Daines nominated me and Senator Tester supported me, recommended me, and Senator Tester supported the president's nomination.
So you shared some of these numbers, you know, how basically, you know, murder, robbery, aggravated assault, violent crime had been increasing double digits in the years running up to you becoming the U.S. attorney. We saw this explosion in meth crimes and meth violations. And I've had other federal law enforcement officers, career federal law enforcement officers on the air on this show say, yeah, we took our eye off the ball in the previous administration. But we don't necessarily need to point the finger of blame here. Either way, it is what it is. You've got to deal with it. You're the U.S. attorney. And so you hit the ground running, you launch Project Safe Neighborhoods, and reinvigorate that program. And it really is a statewide program. You've already expanded elsewhere across the state. Talk about how actually combating this crime and actually taking this drug problem serious makes a difference in how Project Safe Neighborhoods works.
You bet. So when we're looking at why violent crime went up, it's the universal opinion of law enforcement that it's meth driven. We have dealer on dealer violence. We have dealers committing violent crimes against users. We've got armed robbers who are robbing casinos and convenience stores to get money to buy meth to use or sell. I know the county attorney, Scott Twite, over a five-year period increased his armed robbery prosecutions in Yellowstone County by 50%. And then there's a certain number of meth users who become violent. They become paranoid, aggressive, especially people who use a lot of meth over a longer period of time can start to become aggressive and violent. And that was the area that we focused on with PSN. And so together with our local partners, Billings Police Department, Yellowstone County Sheriff's Office, the Rural Police Department, have been great partners. Attorney General Tim Fox's office has been a tremendous partner. And then all of our great federal law enforcement, DEA, FBI, ATF, U.S. Marshal Service, Homeland Security. These guys have been working long hours, Aaron, without any additional bodies. They've been working long hours, missing family activities, missing personal activities to go out and make a difference in this community. And then I'd like to also just recognize the prosecutors at the county attorney's office and at our office. We've got a really dedicated group of AUSAs who are doing these cases, but also other AUSAs who are picking up all the other criminal cases, civil violations we do, civil collections, everything representing the United States in the state of Montana, and support staff who are working hard to make the community they live in safer. It's those guys that deserve the thanks.
One of the frustrating things from my perspective has been that unfortunately in the politics in this country, there's been this idea that we have to accept things as the new normal. Whether, 2% growth, well, that's just the new normal. Just accept it. And it seems like they tried to say that meth and drug crime, that's just the new normal. Just get used to it.
That's a great point, Aaron. Great point. And we can't accept that. That is absolutely the wrong thing. We've got to attack meth on the enforcement side and supply side and the related criminal issues. But as you pointed out today, Yellowstone Substance Abuse Connect has been formed to try to reduce meth demand. So we have a coalition of over 65 government nonprofit organizations in Billings. We're going to have a needs assessment announced today at Riverstone Health, beginning to outline what this community can do to reduce demand.
Apparently already the arrests that are taking place, the takedowns that are taking place, the seizures that are taking place, having a huge impact because they took these double digit increases and brought them down to like 1 point. What was it? U.S. Attorney Kurt Alme with us in studio, 1.6, 1.3%, something like that.
1.3% growth rate, right. So again, law enforcement has just been doing a tremendous job. And these are, you know, everyone's friends. People know them in the community. And these are people who are just working long hours to try to get this done, not only in Yellowstone County, but doing this across the state. And law enforcement really deserves our thanks, you know, and as we head into Peace Officer Memorial Day next week, next Wednesday, we're going to celebrate that in Helena and honor all of the men and women who've fallen in the line of duty. it's a good week to take time and thank one of our sworn law enforcement officers, one of our prosecutors, for the sacrifices that they make to make our community safer.
Yeah, you know, that's a good point too, because, you know, one of the easiest jokes for people to make is making fun of lawyers, and you're a lawyer, so you've heard all the lawyer jokes over the years. But we would typically think of a lawyer kind of just, you know, okay, in the courtroom or behind the desk and you know, but not really getting their hands dirty. Paint the picture for what actually a given day might be like and the actual sacrifices being made by the prosecutors that are out there.
You bet. Again, long hours there too. For instance, we were just over at the Drug Task Force a couple days ago giving letters of commendation to these tremendous officers who are working so hard. And one of our prosecutors came with me, who works with that task force quite a bit. He knows everyone down there. He knows what the office looks like. He knows what their space looks like. He knows everybody's there. Everybody who's there, he's over there looking through evidence, talking to the guys, keeping the communication up, you know, being sure the subpoenas, search warrants, all those things are done so that these guys can keep unraveling these drug trafficking organizations that keep bringing this meth and pushing this meth into our community.
On the human trafficking front, to maybe switch tracks a little bit here too, maybe it ties in together, maybe it doesn't, but is there a connection between the concerns over human trafficking and the drug traffickers as well, even right? Because we know that human trafficking is a big problem right here in our own backyard as well. Luckily, we had some legislation get through the Montana legislature, crack down on some of those illicit massage parlors and things like that. But is there a tie-in between the drug trafficking and the human trafficking from what you've seen so far?
Well, we often see human trafficking as a violent crime. And so certainly, you know, as our focus on violent crime is a lot of our emphasis right now, human trafficking is right in that wheelhouse. We haven't seen a direct connection between the drug trafficking organizations and human trafficking, but that certainly exists in other areas, an area we have to be vigilant about. You know, human trafficking is one of those crimes that's hard to see sometimes. And so we really need the vigilance of everyone, public, law enforcement, business community. Everyone needs to keep their eyes open to spot women who may be, and sometimes men, who may be in very vulnerable situations, and be sure it gets brought to the attention of law enforcement.
And even young kids as well, of course, yeah. I know you probably can't share any numbers yet, but given the fact that you've seen such success in Yellowstone County from the reinvigorated Project Safe Neighborhoods, but you've expanded that across the state, I know you probably can't give any specific numbers yet, but what can you tell us at least about the impacts that you think you're going to see elsewhere across the state of Montana?
Well, the other community we've really focused, we're doing PSN across the state, as you've mentioned, we're targeting these kind of prosecutions across the state, but we've really focused in Billings and Missoula because of the high growth rates of violent crime in those two communities and the high overall number of violent crimes. So we'll be doing a press conference in Missoula at the end of the month. And again, without tipping our hand too early here, we're going to demonstrate again that law enforcement over there has done a tremendous job and has definitely impacted public safety in Missoula.
Well, and if it's impacting there, that can have, you know, broader regional impacts, even to folks up north and Lake County and into Flathead County and some of those others, Mineral Sanders, all of those too.
You know, and that's a great point. You know, PSN, like I said, is a statewide initiative. A lot of the drugs that run up the Western Corridor west of the Continental Divide come in through Missoula, come in across I-90 and then break north, or they'll continue across the state. A lot of our drugs come in through Washington. That's the number one source state. California is number two directly. All those drugs that originally came out of Mexico, Sinaloa cartel meth that's worked its way up the West Coast and then comes into Montana. And so Missoula is really a gateway point through which a lot of the meth and heroin and now synthetic opioids follows to come into the state.
So by cracking down on that unofficial port of entry, shall we say, cracking down on that hub, you also help crack down on the problems in Kalispell and other places in that area. Very interesting. U.S. Attorney Kurt Alme with us here for just a few more minutes. 406-294-0970 is the number. If you have a quick question or comment for Kurt here. Kurt, what, you know, Attorney General William Barr, what's it like now with a new Attorney General? How does your focus change or does it change?
Doesn't change at all. When the Attorney General came on, he had a meeting with all of us, all the United States attorneys across the country, and told us the priorities aren't going to change. We're going to prioritize violent crime. we're going to prioritize opioids. And then we have some other initiatives. Obviously, the southern border has to be a focus area, as well as elder exploitation, as our population grays and tends to become more isolated. But the number one, two focus is violent crime and opioids.
Yeah. And to reiterate for some folks that are out there, because, you know, for some reason, we still end up having to have this debate, you know, because I think most people are aware and will agree that, yes, there is a meth problem. Yes, there is a drug problem. And yes, we have to use every single tool in the toolbox to combat that problem. Nobody's saying that we should only use this tool. We should only use that tool. But there are still some people who will argue and say, well, no, it's not coming from the drug cartels. It's not coming because, I mean, does borders, or, you know, tell us how border security does play a role in this debate also.
Well, and not being on the southern border, it's, you know, I don't know the specifics. I haven't had the chance to be down there myself. But I do know that almost all of our meth and almost all of our heroin is coming across the border from Mexican cartels.
Yeah. And they're going to use every tool in their toolbox, too, to get it across. So
very sophisticated business entities, multinational corporations with very sophisticated distribution methods. Much more difficult problem than we were facing 10 years ago when our meth was home cooked in people's bathtubs. And sometimes we had manufacturers who did such a bad job, they thought they were making meth and they weren't even doing it. This is different. We're now facing very sophisticated manufacturers with a very sophisticated supply model.
You shared a couple stories and case examples of Project Safe Neighborhoods. Is the other day at your press conference, is there a way to paint the picture? This is what your typical meth dealer looks like, or their typical biographical sketch? Is there any way to paint that picture at all?
There isn't. It's more of a location-based. The meth dealers are going to be coming out of California and Washington primarily, and they're going to have a network when they get here. So, for instance, Josh Klaus, I think we put in the press release, we've identified allegedly, a lot of these individuals have been charged, not convicted, so I want to be very clear that these are just allegations. But 14 individuals have already been charged from his organization.
Wow.
Just in the Yellowstone County area. Mr. Klaus himself has already pled guilty and been sentenced. So we see those kind of networks that come into the community. So on the one hand, they're a little more sophisticated and can move volume quicker. On the other hand, because they're a network like that, to some extent, law enforcement has some tools they can use to unravel them that you can't do when distribution is more fragmented.
And this Josh Klaus that you mentioned, only 36 years old in Billings, but apparently... he was the hub of a large-scale meth distribution network between Southern California and Billings. The press release here from the U.S. Attorney's Office noted that when officers eventually arrested him on a warrant, they executed a search warrant on his home. When they arrived, witnesses said later that his accomplices had just finished flushing approximately 10 pounds of meth down the toilet. So they were flushing this down the toilet, trying to get rid of it any way possible. So the rats were scattering all over the place when the authorities showed up on that one, it sounded like.
Yeah, so when you take down when a trafficking organization like that gets hit, it can have significant disruption because, again, it's more organized than what we used to see.
Yeah. And then they also found, he had some illegal firearms that he had hidden inside of a freezer and so much more. So that's where the firearms charges also come in. All right. Well, Kurt, we've only got about a minute and a half or so to go. What else did we not cover yet? What's something you want to tell folks across the state?
Again, this afternoon, I really want to emphasize what's happening in this community with Yellowstone Substance Abuse Connect, with all the organizations that are coming together to try to look at this issue to reduce demand. At 11 o'clock, Katie Loveland, who's one of the consultants who the coalition has hired, we were able to get funding from the Drug Czar's office, and it's going through the police department to United Way. United Way has been able to put together a series of consultants with a lot of us who are on this executive committee and steering committee and membership. You know, again, we have over 65 community member organizations. Because meth is impacting so many areas of the community, there's so much interest. We are all committed, and we all know, getting back to your point, we can't accept the status quo. We have to do a better job of reducing meth supply and demand, and Yellowstone Substance Abuse Connect is our best shot to come up with a community plan that's going to get that done.
Yeah, I was looking at some of the buzzwords here. I'm thinking defense in depth for some of my Navy friends. You know, I'm thinking diversion, enforcement, prevention, treatment, and healthcare depth. I don't know. Anyway, just I know people like those little acronyms or whatever. U.S. Attorney Kurt Alme, great job. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having me, Aaron.